And the root cause of all these problems, it is Article 125, which says that one nation does not have to pay for other nations or their institutions. And that's impossible. You cannot have a currency union without being a transfer union. And if you don't want to be a transfer union, if you don't want to get married or live together, then maybe you shouldn't have a baby either. And the peoples in the member states, they never wanted this kind of financial integration. That's the whole problem. That's why they came up with this unstable behemoth. It looks like a currency union, but it doesn't have the institutions to support the currency union. Mm. So then you end up with a failure.
Welcome to the Gold Republic podcast. My name is Bart Brans.
And I'm Alexei Jordanov. In our weekly podcast, we invite guests from all over the world to get valuable insights
into the emergence of a new monetary system through the lens of precious metals, cryptocurrencies, and other financial instruments. Welcome to a new Gold Republic podcast. Today, our guest is Arno Wellens. Arno is a financial journalist. He's the author of The Euro Religion, and he audits bank balances.
That's my hobby.
In particular, the one of Deutsche Bank. Arno, can you introduce yourself?
I'm afraid you just did, but you're right. I'm a financial journalist. I also used to work in the banking sector at an accounting firm, auditing firm, at the precise moment when these banks were collapsing in the previous credit crisis. If you start reading history books, you can actually see that there's a very interesting pattern which is repeating itself. And I started writing about it just because I think it is very interesting. It is very relevant towards the lives of peoples because, if you have a very unstable banking sector, it has a very detrimental effect on your society. Look at the housing market, for example. Yeah, that's what I write about. To a lesser extent, real estate fraud, very interesting. Trust sector, so the Amsterdam is a corporate tax haven, a safe haven for all sorts of people around the globe that are very interesting.
What were the most edifying kind of discoveries you made in that kind of process?
That's a good question. I should have been prepared for that. What I think is, it is back in 2013, and I've elaborated on that later on. And it is that banks can be saved by their governments without the governments telling their own people, which is what happens right now. And if you look at the data from these banks, if you look at the annual accounts, you can see that there's some mystery fairy that is helping them getting rid of toxic assets.
Why would it do that? What's the incentive?
The incentive is, obviously, you don't want your big banks to fail. If you look at Deutsche Bank, it also handles the sovereign debt of they issue bonds for the German government, and it has a long history. And you don't want to have any financial instability while you're in office. So if you can hide it under the blanket or under the carpet, you will do that. That's what politicians do. They muddle through. And for the bank, being wanted to save is very obvious because you don't want to go bankrupt. But peoples don't want to save their banks. Nobody walks up and says, "Oh, I wouldn't mind a higher tax rate if that helps save my bank." nobody thinks like that. So there's a democratic reason why you don't want to tell your electorate what you are doing. And on a European perspective, certain people want to keep the European project together at any cost, also the euro, and to avoid any nasty situation. You don't want to have to deal with the bankruptcy of UniCredit, for example.
You are quite critical because, you wrote The Euro Religion. Mm-hmm. You're quite critical about the euro, the construction of the euro.
Exactly.
For example, versus...
Not the idea itself. It's not up to me to judge.
No.
But the way it was handled?
Yes. Yeah, you are quite critical. And there's this nice conflict between, for example, the dollar and the euro, which I would like you to elaborate on. And it's how the European balance sheet is actually worse than that of the United States, where most people think that maybe the United States is not doing that good. Can you elaborate?
Exactly. So we discussed it in a previous meeting. The Eurozone is weaker than the dollar system, and the reason is very obvious. If you want to create a currency union, so if you have a group of states, like states of the United States, or independent nation states in Europe, and you want to bind them together, and you want to go as far as having a currency union, it's like having a baby between a couple. You can have two people, you can say, okay, what kind of relationship are we going to have? Well, if you end up with having a child, that's as far as it gets. And you can compare that to a currency union. I mean, two countries can also have a free trade agreement.
So it's a lot of parents.
Yeah, exactly. You have a lot of parents. You have one child, the euro, with 27 parents. And that obviously creates friction. Well, if you want to have a currency union, there's a number of things that you should do. First of all, you remove... By putting them into the same currency union, and it's mainstream economics, it's not that hard. You remove the possibilities, the opportunities that individual governments have to lessen the effects of a crisis in their own state. So if you don't have your own currency anymore, you don't have your own central bank, and all these things, you lose that sovereignty. You can't fight a recession and unemployment at home. So if you are in an adverse scenario, and if you're in a shock, the other guy should step up and help you. So there should be solidarity. And in the United States, with its different history, different culture, they all share the same language or languages, like Spanish, for example, or English. They have these shock absorbing mechanisms. It is in place. So on paper, at least, the United States dollar is working. And it's, like I said, it is mainstream economics. If you write the work of Maurice Obstfeld, for example, he's the chief economist of the International Monetary Fund. He just wrote an article. I will share it with people. He said, well, if you look at the dollar zone, there are states like New York that occasionally pay about 10% of their own national income, their state income, to other states within the dollar zone, to Virginia, for example. And they don't mind. They think it's normal. If you're in it together, if you're the United States of America, one state will pay for the others. And it can go up to 5% and maybe 10% of the income of an individual state. So they know that. If you have... If you have a big vision, if you're very ambitious together, you have to make sacrifices, and then you can ask yourself, are those sacrifices worth it? And that's a political discussion. And people can have their own opinions, but what I say is, you shouldn't. You should at least acknowledge that you have to make those sacrifices. You can't refute that idea, but that's what we're doing in the European Union. Article 125 of the Maastricht Treaty, which gave birth to the euro, says that no state will ever have to pay for any other state. That's impossible.
Is that how do you relate to the current situation? That the article in context.
Everything that happens after that is a correction of that mistake. Like the central bank policy. Central bank right now helps governments issue debt. They don't do it directly. They say, no, it's outright monetary transactions and pandemic purchasing programs, all these different and difficult terms and words that they use. But it boils down to the fact that a central bank, if it wants to, can decide to buy government debt of a specific nation, thereby helping that specific nation. So the idea that the bloc is not going to step up and pay for a member state in trouble, that's an illusion. Only the problem is, now you have a central bank that is going way beyond this mandate, doing all sorts of stuff that it wasn't built, that it wasn't designed for. Therefore, in the United States, the central bank holdings as a percentage of the total economy is half of what it is in Europe. Mm.
It's like 70% in Europe and about 30% in the United States.
Exactly. So because you have these I call it the institutional failure. So you have an institutional gap, you might call it. And there's a reason why we're laughing right now a little bit. People should use their imagination.
The chasm.
That's a better explanation. So when the Eurozone started, the founders of the Euro should have created certain institutions that come with a currency union, like a way to prevent banking crisis, because you have moral hazard in any financial system. If you make that financial system bigger, you get more moral hazard. So bankers, for example, they will speculate that if they create an excessive debt situation in one member state, like let's say Greece or Italy, that eventually the others will help, the other people will help. That's what bankers do. They take a lot of risk and they say, maybe somebody will eventually help me and bail me out. And they speculated on that happening. So you need to have institutions that prevent that from happening. And the Eurozone doesn't have those institutions. Or when they're there, they're way too late. And the root cause of all these problems, it is Article 125, which says that one nation does not have to pay for other nations or their institutions. And that's impossible. You cannot have a currency union without being a transfer union. And if you don't want to be a transfer union, if you don't want to get married or live together, then maybe you shouldn't have a baby either. And the peoples in the member states, they never wanted this kind of financial integration. That's the whole problem. That's why they came up with this unstable behemoth. It looks like a currency union, but it doesn't have the institutions to support the currency union. Mm. So then you end up with a failure.
Talking about, because what's really interesting here is what you talked about is the financial culture of different countries in the bloc. Mm-hmm. For example, Greece and Italy, they have a different financial culture, fiscal culture than, for example, the northern countries.
Yeah.
That seems to result in discrepancies, but also suffering for not only for both parties.
Yeah.
Could you perhaps elaborate that? And because you were talking earlier, you were talking about youth unemployment in Greece.
That's what you get. If you have there's an article, it's called 70 Economists in the Volkskrant. It's a Dutch newspaper. I don't know if it's available in English. And they predicted in 1997, they predicted what would happen right now. And they say that in this situation, with a flawed currency union, the labor factor is going to pay the price. And it is young people that are looking for a job. So there are places in Europe where youth unemployment is still 50%. And those people are paying the price. What's happening is that, look at Greece, for example, but there's other nations as well. And I always say it is not just maybe their culture of how they balance their budget, but if they go into excessive debt, there's also Northern European banks that finance that debt. And those banks take a huge risk as well. So it is a European cultural problem. It is not just their government, it is also Deutsche Bank that is helping Greece doing that. And if you help those governments, you effectively help those banks. And I don't think that you should do that.
Well, wasn't it the whole, actually, like the before even Greece entered the European Union, that there was actually not much of a case for it in the first place from a financial perspective, right?
Like exactly, that's why I call the Euro.
Like a balance sheet.
European religion is the European currency union is a religion. It has nothing to do with facts or there's no rational reason why you should give the euro, but there's a political one. And I know what the reason is. You have a book by a German finance minister, Peer Steinbrück, Verzagte Zukunft. And
great pronunciation.
I love the German language, you know that. Well, what he says, it's very simple. You had the end of the Cold War. Soviet Union was removing its troops from Eastern Germany. Germany could reunite and would be the largest country on the Western European, on the European continent. They would be the economic powerhouse. And France didn't accept that. So France said, if you want to keep the relations as good as they are right now, you shouldn't be an independent state that is larger than France. France doesn't want that. They don't want that to happen. They think that they are still the greatest. They compare themselves to America. We are a superpower. With all due respect, I love France. I love its culture, but it is not. And they wanted to be a superpower. Mm-hmm. It is a very strong country. They have nuclear submarines. They could bomb the shit out of Putin if they wanted to. Then something will come back in return. It is a member of the Security Council, but they consider themselves to be one of the victors of the Second World War. Just like you have the Soviet Union, you have the United States of America, you have France, and together we defeated fascism.
And Britain.
And Britain. That's not entirely correct if you look at the numbers. But that's how France sees itself. They see themselves as a global superpower. And a global superpower can't stand the fact that they're right next to a country in their own continent that's bigger than themselves. They didn't want that to happen. So what they said is, you can reunite, they said to Germany, but then you have to give up the Deutschmark. Because the Deutschmark at the time, people said, that is the nuclear weapon of Germany. Because the Deutschmark, it was a very stable currency, very reliable. People could invest in it like they invest in gold right now, because you know that it keeps its value. German governments, institutions, they will always repay their debts, just like in the Netherlands. It's just that Germany is a lot bigger. And that would effectively make Germany the greatest power on the European continent. From a historical point of view, France didn't accept that. And they said to Germany, you must give up your currency. So we need to create a system in which there are three countries that are equal. And it's Italy, France, and Germany. They're the holy trinity of European integration. They're both equally strong economically, and together they will pull the cart. And for example, if you look at the European Central Bank, the first president used to be a Dutchman, but he had to go after a year or so. Everybody respected this guy, Mr. Duisenberg. Duitenberg, he had a really nice name for a central banker. He was a really diplomat.
Which translated means?
Duits. It is coin. Coin mountain.
Wow.
That's his name.
He was born for his job.
Exactly. And like I said, he was a diplomat. Everybody liked him. He could get along with everybody, and he was well respected in his profession. But he had to go, because the central bank is located in Germany. The first president is French. Then you get somebody from Italy. And if the Italian guy moves, who should then be president? Somebody from France. There's a reason why all the presidents of the European Central Bank are from either France or Italy.
Oh, wow.
Because you have to create the illusion that you have those three states, France, Germany, Italy, that are equally strong, partners in European integration, etc. So you're giving Italy an upgrade, mainly Italy, but Italy can take it. And at the start of the euro, Italy had a debt to GDP percentage of 107. So their government debt was larger than their economy. But under the stipulations of the Maastricht Treaty, you could only enter if you have 6%, 60% or below. So they broke the rules immediately to get Italy in. Mm-hmm. And France insisted on Italy, because France was trying to dilute Germany's power. So he put Germany in a block in a currency union. You get in as many countries as you can, just simply to dilute the German presence. But then you're not asking yourself, is it wise to accept country A, B, or C? And at that time, Greece had a government debt that was slightly below Italy's. So if you allow Italy, you can't refuse Greece. But then you start breaking rules for political reasons. The bankers, they see it and they say, ah,
that's
the no bailout, there's business in there. The no bailout clause will be broken. They knew it.
There were reports of Goldman Sachs saying clearly, it's not, Greece is not solvent at all.
No.
To be even like...
They helped make it look like it.
Yes. Well, there was, they literally, can you even say that?
Yeah.
Can you say that they manipulated numbers or tweaked them?
Absolutely, and it's happening all over again. Mm-hmm. They tweaked the numbers. They allowed Greece to move assets and debts to the balance sheets of Goldman Sachs. And as a result of that, the government debt of Greece looked a little bit lower than Italy's. That's how they got in. And after a few years, the transaction, it's like a derivative contract, the transaction was reversed, and then it turned out that Greece was a little bit less solvent than they thought.
It's financial magic.
No, it is financial witchcraft, maybe. That's
the reason why Greece is in the Eurozone. It is not as if it is somebody thought, hey, it's a good idea, but it doesn't help Greece either, and Italy as well. The Italian economy is smaller than it was 20 years ago. Right now,
they
stagnated for 20 years.
Yeah,
how does their membership of the Eurozone help them? Greece has used unemployment of 50%, and their investments as a percentage of the economy has halved in recent years. So all the investments that you do in your economy, in infrastructure, in new companies, replacement investment for equipment, etc., that is a very important number in economic analysis. Because that is the amount of capital that you have in your economy. I mean, if you have no infrastructure and no companies and whatsoever, yeah, you can't make any money. You can have a very large labor pool, but if there's no investments, then that's capital and labor. They are the production factors. But, and that is halved. Mm. So the investment quota from Greece, it is halved because we're pushing those poor Greek people to pay back loans that they're unable to repay anyway. But in that way, we can keep them in the Eurozone. We can keep them in some sort of a prison. We doom their economy by, like I said, forcing them to repay all those loans. And you are not helping anybody.
When it comes to the Maastricht Treaty, there mm-hmm. were a couple of hard deals there in their rules that mm-hmm. would not be breakable. One of them was the 60% debt to GDP, and also one of them was the 3% balance sheet the
fiscal budget for a year.
Budget deficit, exactly. Since we implemented the euro, we haven't once abided by the two rules.
No.
One time, I believe, we abided by the one rule, the 3% budget deficit. That was in 2019.
Yeah.
What do you feel does it say about not only the experiment of this currency, but also maybe the political powers or political will to make it succeed?
Exactly. That's the whole problem. The political will within the populations in the member states, to make it a success, that will doesn't exist. So if you ask people right now, are you a proponent of the European Union? Then 80% will say, yes. I don't think that you should break up the European Union either. I would prefer to keep the internal market, which is a large success historically, economically. But the euro is a failure. As I say it, you could sacrifice the euro on the altar of European integration in order to save the internal market. That would be, economically, that would probably be wise. But this is the institutional gap, the institutional emptiness, the void that you have. If you start a currency union and one country will run a deficit, that will automatically touch the interests of the other nations. If that were not the case, then why are you talking about budget deficits in your treaty? the fact that you mentioned it in your treaty, thou shall not have to thou shall not have excessive deficits, that there's a reason for that, and it is because it harms the other member states. The political leaders at that time, they probably or obviously believed that if you write something down, that's going to do it. You write down, we shouldn't let that happen. No, we all agree on that, right? Everybody is nodding. Yeah. Then you write it down. But what do you do if somebody breaks the rule? There's no way to address that situation. And in the United States, it works differently. The central government has powers that state governments do not have. And in the European Union, it's the opposite. It is the member states in the European Council, that's what it's called. If they have a meeting with Rutte and Macron and Merkel, that's the most powerful institution. There they decide, okay, we're going to do this, we're going to do that. We're going to save banks, but migration, that might be a mess, that's okay. That's a place where all these decisions are made. So these member states, they give power to a central European authority for as long as they are in that central European authority themselves. And it is like that, let's say in the United States, if the governor of California says, okay, we're going to have a central army, the United States Armed Forces, and that has autonomy to do certain things, but I want to be the one who decides over where that army is going and what it is doing exactly. So the Europeans are not willing to hand over authority to a central institution. Hence, that central institution is lacking, cannot be fully functioning, and that's leaving gaps. And that's exactly what you see happening right now. So the problem indeed is in the Maastricht Treaty, which stipulated that you can do certain things, but if you do them anyway, there's no sanction or whatever. No. But if you break the rules with respect to your fiscal deficit, if you break the rules, somebody else will step up and help you. What do you think is going to happen?
Well, mayhem.
Exactly.
There's a need for a centralized, basically, yes, overarching power, some form of a president, yeah, of the United Nations of Europe.
Yeah, exactly.
To be able to really make those decisions. But also, like, so you have like different branches, and the problem is that they all basically dislocated from each other.
Yes, exactly. And they're internally, they're poor. They're poorly designed. They're disconnected from each other, but all these institutions in themselves are also far too weak to be functioning. If I can maybe give you an example, you have a European Parliament, and in the European Parliament, they're talking a lot about LGBT rights in Europe, and they say, okay, we need an LGBT inclusive zone, and that should be the entire Europe, because there's something going on in Poland and Hungary. And you see them on Twitter with their hashtags and the t-shirts and their buttons. But did you know that a member of a European Parliament, so the lawmaking body in a democracy, the European Parliament cannot make any laws. So whenever you see a member of Parliament, a European member of Parliament, promoting something, he or she is doing something that they can do because Article 225, the Treaty on the Functioning of the European Union, the European Constitution, it stipulates that a member of Parliament, European member of Parliament, can request the Commission or the Council to do something. They can do something on their own. That power was never given to them. And if they request something from the executive power, which they are supposed to control, but they obviously can't, and they receive a hard no. So, hey, European leadership, could you please maybe do this or that? No, piss off. Then they have a right to request why they are being treated like that. That's the only power they have. If you go to Europe, to the European Parliament, you see that sometimes they're passing laws, maybe 10 laws in 1 minute. And then they say, okay, now it's time for lunch. They don't have any debates over there. They sometimes do because they film it and then they can use it on their social media channels. But everything that is presented to the European Parliament is something that the European Parliament agreed on. Otherwise, it wouldn't have been asked to them. They don't have the right of initiative. They don't have the right to start a petition and say, okay, we need to make a law on something that we think is important, but the executive power does not think is important. If, for example, you want to decrease the pay of the European Commission, well, the European Commission isn't going to propose that itself. Obviously, that's the Parliament should do that. They can't, but for that reason, they don't have the decision-making power to do so. So they can only respond. So it's always yes, 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 we vote yes, we vote yes. Because if they wouldn't have agreed with it, it wouldn't have been asked to them anyway. And that's an example of European state leaders, of the sovereign nation states. They don't want to hand over legislative power to a central body. Then the central body can't really function, do anything, is disappointing, then you get a mess. It is very obvious.
Is there a way, because what you're describing now is something that is on a dead-end road.
Yeah.
First of all, is it a dead-end road? And is there a way that we can fix some of these issues in which you would perhaps see a functioning European Union and perhaps even a functioning euro?
Well, if you want to have, let's say, if you want to have a European Union with a euro, and I think that we should strive to not having a euro but an internal market. But let's say you want to have a euro. You need to have a number of things. And there's been Nobel Prize winning economists, chief economist of the IMF, Maurice Obstfeld, they all wrote it down. First of all, you need a central budget committee. There needs to be a treasurer on a European level. So that's if Greece or any other country, it started with Germany, by the way. Germany was one of the first countries to break the 3% rule, and then Greece got angry.
All right.
That happened in 2002. Most people don't remember that, but that's how it started. So Germany said in 2002, okay, we made this agreement, but we're going to break it anyway.
Because they could? Or
because they could, exactly, because they have the right to do so. You need to remove the right from a local government to do that. So you need to effectively end the Ministry of Finance that you have in each country. Like the central budget in the United States. The United States government has the right to levy taxes. State governments also. So one can levy corporate income tax, and the other as a value-added tax. But the United States government and can service a large debt because people believe that those debts will be repaid at some point in time. And that is sort of a realistic assumption because the central government in the United States can impose taxes and the European Commission cannot. So, but now they can, thanks to Corona, that is being used as an excuse to fill these gaps. But that is something that you need. You need a central budget authority. Central budget authority, the European finance minister, needs to be able to issue debt to respond to certain crises. It's a local crisis. You need to issue debt. You need to impose new taxes. So there needs to be a lawmaking body in Brussels that can say, okay, everybody European will now pay 10% more tax, which will go directly to Brussels. You need those sort of things. If you're there, if you're completely integrated monetarily and economically and politically, then you will need a European army. You will need a European police force. Because if you have removed all the internal borders, then the states at the edge of the Schengen Treaty, that's what it's called, they are obviously the border states for the entire bloc. I mean, if there's a migration crisis, apart from your opinion on migration, but all the migration problems in the United States are in Texas, because Texas is on the edge of the bloc. In Europe, it's Greece. Greece is on the edge of the Schengen zone. We need to have a European police and migration policy financed from Brussels that can exert force and power locally.
But that's
and then you have a European government. Yes. You need to do all those things, and then you can have a functioning euro system. And countries like the Netherlands, they should accept that they are going to pay 5 to 10% more tax, and that's about 500 euro per working Dutchman per month.
That's yeah.
And you shouldn't be whitening every month, every year. That's your investment in the common project. And if you don't feel that amount of solidarity, I say, well, don't.
It's hard for me to envision the other way around, that we say that we dilute. So for all the proponents of, I don't know, like Frexit, Nexit, German exit, whatever exit, Brexit. Mm-hmm. is that, of course, in Britain's case, it was a bit of a different case anyways. But
because they didn't have the euro.
They had access to the market, yeah. Right? They had their pounds. Either it's going to go into pseudo-civil state wars of if things like start break down, which I don't really believe or I hope not will be the case. But there's no backtracking. So obviously, decentralization would actually also create conflicts within countries themselves. Yeah. People not feeling represented by overarching authority, which would basically impose them on things on supranational level.
Exactly.
And then we're already seeing that. We're seeing movements not just in the Netherlands, but also in Hungary, in France, in Germany, in all major countries in Europe. People are also, from a sentiment
perspective.
That's
very worrisome. That's a very worrisome.
It's a bit of a deadlock situation.
Right? Yeah. And I want to get out of the deadlock. I'm not saying that you should either have the euro or not. I'm just saying that you can't go on like this. If our political establishment, if they truly want to have this euro, then be honest about it. Don't lie to us. And that's what our government is doing right now.
Accountability.
Accountability. Mm-hmm. Just say what you want, name your price, propose it, and see what happens. Maybe a referendum. I think a referendum on the euro would be a very good idea.
Well, we saw what it did in Britain.
The situation in Britain is different because...
But don't you think, Arno, that
they don't have the euro?
Yeah,
but they haven't signed Schengen treaty.
It's even more difficult. Imagine in Brexit, people barely understood what the role of Britain was within Europe, the European Union, and also like the access to the market of the European Union. People had no education about it, and they purely voted on sentiment and all the propaganda that also was fueled on both sides, maybe. But so, let alone speaking about the euro, which is ourselves, like we're trying to spend like some time understanding it.
Okay. The problem here, if you have discussions like this, and I have them all the time, you can imagine, is that European integration, it is actually three steps. It is a three-step pyramid. First of all, you have the internal market, which has been around basically since the Second World War. And let me repeat that. The European market... And the European Economic Community, not the European Union, but the European Economic Community, was a reaction to the Second World War. It was built around French and German reconciliation. And I think that is the best thing that European history has ever created. That's markets.
Why?
Because you give people a common interest. You can tell a German and a Frenchman, okay, if you work together on this, you'll both get rich. And it's a two-way situation. The problem is that if you extend that project beyond to the point where one actually has to pay for the other, that's more difficult. You can immediately feel where that's going to get wrong.
I say France sending a ticket to Germany or the
exactly.
other way around.
Then the German will get less enthusiastic
Don't
about
ticky
it.
Me.
You're not going to ticky me. But what if you say, okay, if you make peace, you can both send a ticket to a third person. And then you say, okay, but I want to extend the peace. I want to get more and more and more ambitious politically. And then eventually one of them can send a ticket to the other. And the other guy is going to be less enthusiastic about it. You want to have peace and you want to have your belly full. And peace is also a result of a full belly, because otherwise you'll start to rebel. But that's the European internal market. And if membership of the European Economic Community, I would like to go back to that, means that you can sell your stuff that you make in the Netherlands to somebody in Italy or whatever. That's great. And the economic benefits have been calculated, and it's very simple. You can see that free trade like that works. It's also beneficial for all the members that partake in it. That's why Great Britain joined the European Union in the first place in 1973, because it was an attractive idea, because it actually worked.
Free markets only function if there is a benefit for both parties.
Exactly. So you have an open door policy. It is not to keep people in, preventing them from going out, but actually people want to come in, and that's the start of a European economic community. It was a great success. Then you had the Schengen Treaty. That's where it started to go wrong. And that's the second layer. That is migration. So you have market, migration.
You have monetary. Free movements of goods and services.
Exactly. And that's number one. That's
the physical,
a great idea.
Human layer.
Yeah. And then you say, okay, no, we need to have endless migration within Europe. Well, that automatically means that you have to that you together have to check your external borders, which costs money and makes that you have to hand over sovereignty to Brussels.
And send each other a ticky,
because somebody, you can't say to Greece, you know what, the migrant situation, people drowning, whatever, you fix it yourself. But why do you think that so many migrants want to go to Greece?
Yeah, well, no, it's just Greece, also Italy.
Exactly.
And again, Italy and Greece.
Exactly, the two countries that are also...
So that basically fueled the fiscal deficit and budget deficit.
Even more, but you need to help them. You need to say to them, exactly, you are our gatekeepers. If you want to have a humanitarian and a decent, but also a safe migration policy, it's going to happen in those two states. What we say to those two states is, you need to do budget cuts with terrible, terrible effects on those countries. Mainly Greece, like I said, the total investments because of these budget cuts and tax increase, it is breaking their economy. And while that happens, we say, oh, by the way, you also need to say to fix that migration situation, and we're not going to help you doing so. We're not going to give you a penny. That's literally what our prime minister said to win the elections in the Netherlands.
He said,
yes, Greeks, you're not going to get a penny from us.
But
you do need to fix the migration situation, because, well, people in the Netherlands are talking about migration, and it's fueling the electoral debates. Well, that can't work. So either you pay, and if you don't want to pay, the love isn't there, and then you shouldn't get cozy in bed and make children. But anyway, you have the market situation, you have migration. That's another step towards European integration, and then you have the currency situation, that's on top. And we used to have a Europe without a common currency, but with a common market. And that situation was a success. If you...
Sorry.
Excuse me. If you move from a free market situation to a currency, to a common currency, the benefits of that particular move are very, very small, and they can probably even be measured. Especially now, because most of your transactions are digital anyway. And the number of times that a particular Dutchman or whatever goes to another country and needs to have other coins and bills in his wallet, it doesn't happen so often. So the internal market was a success. The common currency isn't, because the benefits of a common currency aren't really there. But if you have a common currency, you take away the possibility for those poorer countries to debase their currency and stay competitive, so the economies will decline. And in order for prevention of the decline of their economies, you need to levy taxes in the Netherlands, up to 5-10% of our gross national income. The benefits that the euro will yield are never, never, ever going to be close to 5-10% of our GDP.
Well, because
it's a big mistake. We should never have done this.
Maybe because there's also other inefficiencies. Because if
what
we have,
what inefficiencies?
Well, the inefficiency of the what you just mentioned before, the institutions, the fact that there is no overarching power authority that can basically manage those deficits and rebalance basically like those problems. But isn't like so that now it doesn't work doesn't mean it can't work in the future either.
It can work, absolutely, but we know what the price is that we have to pay.
Okay,
is there
and that is up to at least 5% of our gross national product should be going to a fund in Brussels, a permanent European financial stability mechanism. Everybody pays 5% of their state income into that fund, and then you are prepared for the next crisis. Because that fund didn't exist, the European Union was not prepared for the next crisis. And then you say, okay, then the central banks needs to fix it. But the central bank only has some very crude tools. They have hammers and axes and that sort of stuff. They can't really do. They can't really help a particular member state. That's illegal. So they print a lot of money to buy government bonds of all countries, but the Netherlands doesn't need it. What you have now, you have a housing bubble in the Netherlands as a result of the European Central Bank axing around at the crisis.
Should there be a moment where we conclude either we proceed or we just stop? Is that possible?
Like I said, look at youth unemployment in Greece. Look at the economic situation, also in Italy. This debate we should have had in 2010. Then you say, okay, we've tried something. We've tried a Eurozone with its flaws, praying that a crisis will never hit us because we made a decision to not prepare ourselves for a crisis. Then you have your financial crisis. You know that you're not prepared. And you see the terrible, terrible effects on the lives of people. You see that they start to radicalize, which is understandable. And then you should have a debate. And I proposed a parliamentary inquiry into the matter.
And?
It was declined because people didn't want to have this conversation.
Because, you're opening up the inner, like the guts, the
exactly.
Stinking guts.
That's why people hate me. They try to frame me in
a lot of criticism.
Exactly.
Is there a witch hunt on you at the moment?
Absolutely. I can notice that in many ways that people, they treat me like I'm a...
Because you basically put the finger where it hurts. Or what?
Exactly. And if you... if they take the opportunity to talk with me for some time, then they say, okay, well, actually, you're right. Mm-hmm.
But it's easier to just put you in a frame and call you names.
Yeah. But like what I said, look at the situation with Greece, for example. But that's a cheap one. That's a cheap solution. Italy is the gorilla in the room.
Before you continue, the fact that now Mario Draghi, former ECB president, is now the head of prime minister of Italy.
Very democratic. The Italy cannot, and Greece, they can't choose their own government officials anymore.
Who knows the game?
That's who knows the game, exactly. But the other member states, during the height of the previous euro crisis, other member states decided who should be prime minister in Greece. In the oldest democracy on this country. The people who invented...
The first reason why we even got them in the European Union was because of the symbolic.
Yeah.
Of to what I understand.
Exactly. And then you do that to them.
We baffle it back by...
That's terrible. So is that what the European Union is coming to?
What was the evidence of that move?
Well, Varoufakis, it's a finance minister, he explained all this. He said, well, you have a prime minister that is against austerity. But, hey, you need our money, so... And that's now you start to add one democratic inadequacy on another. Because... Now the central bank has to be the lender of last resort and the bringer of stability. But the central bank has no democratic legitimacy. It is no, there's no way for me, for example, as a journalist. I do that sometimes. I call them and I see them doing something really crazy. And then say, why do you do that?
Like what? What's the last example?
For example.
We're coming to an end to the first part of episode with Arno Wellens, in which we just covered the basics of why the euro is not functioning and... The institutions are not really equipped for it. In the second part, as this little teaser already hinted, we touch upon some corruption cases that Arno unveiled and why he believes the European Central Bank is actually going over its initial mandate without any checks and balances and control, and what he thinks is kind of undemocratic. We also look at some practices where banks kind of hide toxic assets or rotten assets like underperforming loans through some quantitative easing made by the European Central Bank. We'll explain kind of like the details about it in this episode. We also asked Arno what he believes is the next crisis, systemic crisis, that will take place in Europe. And it's a dilemma between saving the banking sector and the housing market. It's a very exciting episode, really insightful. I gotta say it was a fascinating conversation we had with Arno. If you've liked this episode, please give it a like. If you haven't subscribed yet, find the subscribe button down below. You can also leave us comments in the comment section, have feedback or any question, we'll try to answer them. If you're listening to us on Spotify, Apple, or any other podcast platform, please leave us a review. It's really important. It helps us reach more people out there. In the meantime, stay safe, stay healthy, and I'll see and hear you in the next episode of the Gold Republic podcast.